Okay. So right. So for some people, the microservices operand might be like an idea that makes sense to you. Like you want to be able to zoom in and have microservices working for you, something like that. The term microservices, what I'm about to talk to you about, came from David Dalrymple. So thanks to him for that term there. But for other people, you might be more compelled by knowing that some very standard math thing is related to some other standard math thing. So the free monad on poly is a module over the cofree comonad on poly. And I'll explain what those mean. And hopefully you can say like, oh, this might actually be interesting because the math is so clean. Or you might say, the math is interesting to look at because the motivation is useful. So this other stuff on the board, I'll get to later. It's all like some formulas I didn't want to have to write later. But the idea is to, for the microservices thing, is to look at polynomial functors, as problems and solutions. So, polynomial as problems and solutions. So if you have a polynomial functor, your polynomial might be like y cubed plus 3y or something like that, and you could redraw that as a bundle with four dots, because if you apply one to this, you get four, and then that's the base of the bundle, and the fiber of the bundle, or the total space of the bundle, is to put three dots over this one and one dot over each of these three. And so we would say that this problem had three solutions, this problem had one solution, one solution. Now, why would you want to look at it that way? Well, what is a map of polynomials? A map of polynomials from this one to some other one. What is one of these? Well, it's a way of sending problems in P to problems in Q. So each one of these problems gets sent to a problem. And for any solution to that problem, it gives you, well, that was a pretty easy one, but it gives you a choice of solution to that problem. So I'm going to say y squared plus 2y. Okay, so it's a way to take problems in P to problems in Q, and then solutions in Q, and return solutions in P. So if you, okay, so then what would happen if you had a map from P to Q1 tensor Q2? Well, I'll explain what tensor means later in the talk. But what this is what this will end up being is, for every problem in P, you ship it to a problem in Q1 and Q2. And then when they each are able to solve their problem independently, you take that pair of results and return a result or a solution to P. And a map from P to Q1 compose Q2 says, for every problem in P, I'm going to hand it to a problem in Q1. And for whatever solution it gives me, I'm going to hand that to a problem in Q2 to solve. And then for whatever solution that gives, I'm going to return a solution in P. So this is like a two-step procedure for taking problems in P, running Q1 and Q2, and then taking the result and returning a result for P. So I first learned this perspective of problems and solutions from Reed Mullinix, who will be at the Poly Hackathon next week. And of course, you could combine these in larger and larger expressions, and that's kind of what I mean by this microservices operad, is that we're going to be talking about a category where the objects are polynomials, or an operad where the objects are polynomials, and the morphisms from P to Q, from P to Q1 through Qn is ways of taking a P problem and giving it to Q1 through Qn to solve. Any number of them can kind of work in series or parallel, and then finally return you an answer. And that's an operad, meaning you can keep going all the way down with that. So the math of this is that CP, the cofree comonad, tensor, the free monad on Q, there's a map from that to P tensor Q, free monad on P tensor Q. And this is what makes the microservices operad work. And it satisfies some equations that says that C is action, this is an action. So it says, like, if I do C, I don't know if you can see this, but CP1 tensor CP2 acting on MQ. Like I could either compose them first in the C thing and then apply, or I could apply them one at a time and that commutes, and so it's like an action. And so this is a module. And we'll get again to those formulas over there and those commutative diagrams over there in a second. But the NLAB page has something about modules of one functor over another functor, and that's what this is. Okay, so that's the math, and then finally we're going to get this into something called org. Org is something I defined a while ago. It's a category-enriched operat, and it's about organizations that kind of change their behavior. And so Brandon and I wrote a paper where we showed that like deep learning and other things like that are operads operads enriched in org, or which we call dynamic operads. So org is this category of like dynamic organizations. And so we'll show that in fact what's going on here is that this thing means that org has both a monad and a comonad on it. Sorry, that C is a functor from org to org. And M is also a functor from org to org. This second one, that M is a functor from org to org, it's actually a monad, relies on this fact here. And so then we can take the Kleisley category of M, or the Clo-Kleisley category of C, and we will show that for any monad, we can get from the Kleisley category of M to the Clo-Kleisley category of C, with an op in there. So what all this is saying is that this org M thing is going to be our microservices operat, and this org C thing is like a generalization of stuff that Brandon and I have been working on for a while. It's like basically these are kind of like wiring diagrams that update themselves. So org C is something about wiring diagrams like this that people have seen all over the place, but where you're allowed to have things moving faster. Like this one might be doing 5 operations every second, and this one might be doing 18 operations every second, and that's the kind of thing that can live in org C. And not only that, but these are updating themselves or something like that. Like the wiring diagram themselves are changing. So it's a very general thing, and all I'm saying here is that org M, this microservices operat, maps into this one. So we can actually get behaviors in this kind of very material sense or whatever of these machines that are computing and chunking along using, we can implement that. We can implement the microservices operat using that. So the plan is that I'm going to talk to you about poly for a little while, and then I'm going to tell you about free monads and co-free comonads, and then I'm going to show you how this all works. So it's 4 parts. We are done with 1 part. So part 2 is, this was the intro, I guess. 1, intro. And then 2 is tensor try or and this thing on poly. So, okay. So polynomial functors are, a polynomial functor is like the sum over some indexing set of some powers of y. And I often write this as, it turns out if you plug in 1 for y, you get p of 1. Sorry, p of 1 is b, so this b, I don't know if I should be writing this or not, y to the p bracket I. This is just notation I use. This thing is this thing, and this thing is this thing. Okay, so what is p tensor q? P tensor q is the kind of thing that just puts p and q in parallel, and its positions are pairs ij in p, like in the base of the first one and the base of the second one, and its directions at any ij is just the directions of the first one times the directions of the second one. P or q is P plus P tensor Q plus Q. And this is a monoidal structure on any category when you have a distributive monoidal. Let's say you have a monoidal category that distributes over coproduct. You can always make this new monoidal structure whose monoidal unit is zero. So in sets, like since times distributes over plus, the set S plus S times T plus T is the monoidal, is a monoidal product for S and T. So it's kind of an interesting thing. I've never found it useful before. Actually, once I did on a paper with Joella and Andrea Chensi, but so we'll be using this. Basically, what this will be is when you have like a bunch of microservices, but you only want to use some of them sometimes. You're using some of them in parallel, and you're leaving somebody else. So I say like I can either use you, or use you, or use both of you. So it comes up for that reason. But also because we'll find that the free monad is monoidal with respect to or, but not with respect to other things. So it's kind of forced on us, and it makes sense. The P compose Q means, if you think of P and Q as functors, we're just plugging Q into P. It's just the usual P compose Q, but it's for objects in poly rather than morphisms. We're thinking of functors as objects. So what it is the sum of, I could write it. We're just composing functors, so we just take one of these functors and plug it into the other. But in terms of trees, if we think of this guy as a tree that looks like as a bunch of corollas, we would see it as this bunch of corollas. Because there's three over the first one, one, two, and one. And when we compose it with another polynomial functor, thought of as a bunch of corollas, what you do is you take all possible ways of stacking these on top of these. So you could put this one on all three, that would be an example. You could put this one on this one, and this one on these two. And you could take all the different ways of doing that. And that is P composed Q. Now the reason that's interesting is like P composed P, composed P, composed P, is like taking, so in this, let's say p was y squared plus y, which would draw as like this thing, that thing, maybe plus one. Then inside of p plus p plus p plus, or p composed p composed p composed p, might be like, p composed p composed p, let's dot that one off and let's put that there. So this would be one example of a thing in P compose, P compose, P compose, P. The reason is at every stage you see one of these three things, and then on top of, and then it branches, and then you see another one four times. Any questions about these monoidal structures, or especially seeing composition as trees? The reason I wrote this symbol, this compose symbol, because first of all, it's like you're plugging Q into P. Second of all, if you write it fast, it looks like a composition symbol. And third of all, it looks like tree, like Q is a top P growing up. So all those ways of looking at it coincide. And both the cofree comonad and the free monad, that the reason this is coming up and I'm spending time on this tree stuff is that both of these are going to be built up as trees. Okay. So the last one is P internal hom Q. This is the internal hom for tensor. So, but I'll tell you what it is. It's the product for every position in P. You have to give it a position in Q. And then for every direction there in Q, you have to give a position in P. Direction P. And that's the set of polynomial maps from P to Q. You put a 1 there, that's the set of maps from P to Q. But if you put a Y there, that's the internal hom. The way I often write this is that it's the sum. You choose a polynomial map from P to Q. And then once you do it, you basically put So you may prefer this one because it tells you that it kind of distributes this thing and kind of tells you that the positions of this are really the maps of polynomials, and the directions, a direction of this is a position of this and a direction of that. And the reason you might, or you might prefer this one because it's like this sigma pi alternation thing that's kind of easy to look at. Now, why might you be happy that the, it's easy to be happy that the positions of this are the function, are the morphisms from P to Q, but why might you be happy that the directions of this are, a direction is a position of P and a direction of Q? The reason is that if you have a position of P and then a direction of Q there, you also have a position of Q and you also have a direction of P. So you have all four pieces of data, not just two. So it's a very reasonable, it's like reasonable answer. Okay. Any questions? So next I want to tell you about the free monad and the cofree comonad on any P. Okay, so we're in part three. Free monad and the cofree comonad. So in computer science, I've heard that free monads come up in like Haskell and stuff like that. But they're also just kind of very syntactic things. If you have a if you have a functor, you can take, I don't know if you can always take the free monad on it, but if it's polynomial, you can. So so the formula for the free monad on P, so M is a functor from poly to poly. It takes a polynomial P, returns M sub P, and this is the free monad on P. So what's a monad? Well, a monad, it's a polynomial together with a map from that polynomial composed with itself to itself. So if you have a tree of, if you have a P and then you stack an MP thing and you stack an MP thing on top of all of its leaves, you can consolidate that down to be an MP thing. And similarly, there's a unit MP thing. So what is it? Well, what it is you basically, I think I said it before, but you basically can branch according to P-ish stuff. So you can branch as much as you want according to P and then stop whenever you want to. And this would be an example of an element. So it's like a syntax tree. If P was like plus times y squared plus minus y plus 0, 1. This is the polynomial. It's 2y squared plus y plus 2. And inside of the free monad on P would be things like plus times minus 2. This would be an element. And this would be one position in this polynomial.
So where's the 2 coming from?
Why did I write 2? 0. Thanks. This would be one position in this polynomial. And the directions would be the three variables that are left open. So it's syntax trees. We can also think of it as like decision trees. It's like, instead of thinking we're gonna do a bunch of stuff and consolidate stuff, you could just say like question mark sub 1 has 2 things that can happen. Question 2 has 2 things that can happen. Question 1 has 2 things that can happen. Whatever. So you could just have some decision tree that says like, well, here's your decision tree. If you tell me like, for each question, if you give me a solution, if each of these is a problem, so back to problems and solutions, if P was problems and solutions, it would say if you give me a problem, and then for every solution, you give me a new problem, and for every solution, you give me a new problem, blah, 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 and then the remaining things here would be the decisions that the person could choose. So I don't know how, yeah, hopefully that was clear enough. So how do you define the free monad? You basically take a colimit of a bunch of things. You take a colimit starting with y, and define p like lower 0 to be y, and pi plus 1 to be y plus p composed the previous one. So we get y, and then y plus p, and then y plus p composed y plus p.
And so the y's represent the dangling?
Y's represent the dangling,
yeah.
Yep. Yeah. So we're like, we either have an empty tree, or we have a one-step tree. Like we either have this, this, or this, or a kind of empty tree. And then for any one of these dangling things, like let's say plus, for any one of these dangling things, either we don't do anything, we just leave it dangling, or we put another tree on top. And so we just keep allowing ourselves to build like that, and it's a colimit, which means you do a finite number of these. Like you can choose as far as you want, and consider just kind of be putting empty trees on top for them from then on. Now this is only when p is finitary. When p, what that means is when there's like a finite set of directions for each coefficient, for each position. If you want to have infinite directions here, then you take a limit of these colimits. But it's not a bad thing. It's bad because it's like hard to say, but it for some reason is very, very tame in terms of like working with it. You can usually peel that limit off without worrying about it because it's a filtered limit. So that's the free monad. And then what's annoying, what you could say, oh no, why is the free monad not it's not monoidal with respect to tensor. That's kind of annoying. But the reason is because if I have a syntax tree in P and there's another syntax tree in Q, if they're not the same shape, you can't just make a syntax tree in P composed in P tensor Q. But there is P or Q, that weird thing that, like, at first I thought only a mother could love, like, who would ever think of this thing as important, in fact absorbs in, like, all these things. Like, it is lax-monoidal receiving all of these different structures, including itself. So it's saying that if you have a tree of P, a P tree, or a Q tree, well, then you get a P or tree Q, P or Q tree. That one's easy. That one's kind of automatic. If you have a P tree and a Q tree, and you want to put them, you want to kind of consolidate them into one tree, you just go as long as you can on P, and as long as P and Q are both outputting stuff, tensor them, because where is P or Q? It tensor them, and as soon as one of them kind of stops, then just start doing the other ones for the rest of the time. If you have a P tree, and then at every leaf you have a Q tree, then you could just do the P-ish stuff for a while, and then the Q-ish stuff for a while. Yeah, if you have a P tree or a Q tree or a P tensor or a combination of them, then we can just use the ones above to get into that thing. So these are all monoidal structures and or, but it's kind of interesting that, I don't know. So what is M, P, or Q? It says that at every stage, we can either pick a thing in P as our problem to solve or a thing in Q or both. And then we just have to solve we have to solve one or the other or both. So I don't know if that makes sense. M, P, or Q says we take P plus P tensor Q plus Q, and we allow our trees to be built on those. So at every stage, we either have a P-ish thing or a Q-ish thing or both, and then the branching is, if it's P-ish thing, it branches like P, if it's Q-ish thing, it branches like Q, and if it's both, it has the product of the branching. Okay, so that's that. And the last thing I want to say about free monads is that M is a monad. So M is a monad on poly. So first of all, it takes any polynomial and gives you a polynomial monad. But like a functor from set to set, like MP is a polynomial, but that means it takes set to set. Every polynomial is a functor from and M sub P is a monad. So all of that, this really should belong over here. MP, taking set to set, is a monad on set. But now we're saying that M itself is a monad on poly, which means that we have a map from P to MP for any polynomial P, and we have a map from M of P to M of P. And so just to intuit what this means, it's saying if you have a position in your polynomial, you have some kind of thing here, then you can get a tree out of it, just the one-step tree. And this is saying if you have a tree where every position in that tree is actually a whole tree, and then you take that whole tree, and then you put a whole tree on every leaf, then you can consolidate that to be a single tree. So any questions? And by the way, a monad, a polynomial monad is exactly an algebra for the free monad monad. M is free monad monad. And an arbitrary polynomial monad is the same thing as an algebra on this, on M. We don't need to know that, but I'm just telling you in case you think that's interesting. Any questions about the free monad in terms of trees? Free monad, monad? Because next I'll do the cofree, comonad, comonad. Okay, so we have this C thing taking poly to poly. And it's going to be a monad on poly, a comonad on poly. We take a polynomial and return a new polynomial called CP, free, cofree, comonad on P. So CP is a functor from set to set, and it's a comonad. Like, if you take CP of X, it maps to X. And it maps also to CP of X. I'm not saying you need to know that, it's just that's what it is. It's like a very canonical thing to want. In category theory, you might want the cofree comonad on something. But it has a nice description in terms of trees, and that is that it just branches, so let's say, what is CAY to the B? Is the set of A branching, B branching A trees. Paths. Okay. Okay, so what am I saying? If A is 2, if A is 3 and B is 2, then you would be, like, you would write 1, 2, or 3 at every stage, and then you would branch twice at every stage. This is 3y squared. It's a tree that at the root writes one of the positions of this polynomial, and then branches according to the directions, and then repeats. So it's just printing elements of this and then branching according to that. Okay, and the formula is you have this Q, define the zeroth, we're gonna define CP as the limit of some other polynomials. This time we don't have to worry about finitariness or anything else. We're gonna take the limit of some projections. And so so Q0 is just Y, just like P0 was Y. And qi plus 1, instead of being y plus p composed pi, it's y times q composed qi. It just replaces plus with times. And so q parenthesis 1 is y times q. q2 is y times q composed y times q. And it's easy to write down the projections. Like qi plus 1 to qi, basically, it's some kind of inductive thing. And so what that says over here is that to form CQ, you have to form all these other things. You have to say, what's at the base? Tell me the positions at the base, and then the branching there is all the branches there plus an identity, a kind of stay where you are. That's what it's doing. So what I forgot to tell you is that C A Y to the B, the directions, one of these big trees is a position in this C thing. So inside CP, a position is like one of these branching trees, and a direction there is any finite path from the root up. So a direction, this is a direction, stay where you are, and that's what this Y is doing. It's getting you one extra direction. Okay, so questions on, let's see, like C, inside of like C of Y plus one might be something that just goes and then stops. Because it's allowed to, like there's another one in here that's just a stop, there's another one in here that's like this one. And there's one that goes forever. So what it's saying is that we're gonna, at every stage, we're gonna print either Y or one, and then if it's Y, we're gonna keep going, and if it's one, we're gonna stop forever. Okay, so there's some similarity between the free monad and the co-free comonad. Oh, and I forgot to say that this is a comonad on poly. So C of P maps to P, and the co-free on P also maps to the co-free on the co-free on P. But again, there's some relationship between this free monad, in our minds at least, between the free monad and the co-free comonad. The free monad has finite trees, and only the leaves count as directions. The co-free comonad has infinite, possibly infinite trees. The only way they're allowed to stop is if you hit a constant term of P at everywhere. So it has these usually infinite trees, but a direction is any finite path up. Not just leaves, because there aren't any leaves. So there's some relation between them, but they aren't made up. They're actually the free monad and the free comonad. They're real things. So why are they different? How are they related? And at some point last year, I said that the free monad on P is a basis for the pro-discrete topology. So there's something called like pro-finite sets and things like that, and on CP. So this thing always forms a topological space, and this is a basis. But the stuff I'm going to tell you today and the rest of the time is that actually falls out of, I'm not going to explain the connection unless someone asks, but that falls out of this more general story about modules.
What's the co-unit on CP?
What is the co-unit on CP? Do you mean, there's two ways I could take that. Do you mean this thing?
Yeah, what's that map?
Okay, sure. So this is a map of polynomials. Mm-hmm. It takes a gigantic tree of P branches. So it prints a P at everything and branches and then puts another one.
Yeah.
And just returns the bottom thing, just the bottom corolla, and then for every direction here returns the finite path, I forgot to say path, but the finite path of this tree that goes and stops there. So it just like in the free monad, this map takes a corolla and P and returns the corolla, the tree with just that one thing. This takes a tree with a gigantic thing and returns just the corolla at the bottom.
Thanks.
Sure. Okay. Okay, right. So there's this natural map. So what stage am I on? Four. Right? Oh no, it's still three. That doesn't matter to you guys. So there's a module. So CP M is a module over C. And Brandon and I, mainly Brandon, worked out that like you can think of C and P as endofunctors on poly, and then work in the date convolution, and then this really is a monoid, and this really is a comonoid, and they really are, well, this really is a tensor product, and this really is a module in some normal, usual sense. But I'm not going to need that level of sophistication. I just want to say there's one of these maps for every P and Q. And the way you're supposed to think of it is you have some finite tree in Q and some infinite tree in P, and we can just kind of pair them as long as P is going, keep pairing them. And then if we, so that gives us a map from positions of this times positions of this to positions of this. And then if we have a leaf in this thing, how do we get a finite path here and a leaf here? Well, it's kind of not so hard to see, I guess. Like, we took this infinite tree, this finite tree, and we paired them as long as the finite tree was lasting. We took any leaf there, returned the leaf here, and returned the finite path up to that leaf there. Right? It wasn't a leaf here, but the finite path up to the point where this one went. So maybe I should draw a picture. So this one's like this infinite thing. Maybe we're on P is y squared and Q is 2y. So 1, 2, I don't know, 2y squared. 1, 1, 2. This one goes on forever. Maybe this is 2y squared also. A, B, A, A, B, A, B. Branching on and on and on forever. And so what you do when you pair them is you write like A1, and then you have four directions, which I guess I shouldn't draw, but you have B1, B2, A1, and A2. And you keep going, and then as soon as you don't need to branch in here anymore, you stop branching there too. This one just goes as long as you want. This one tells you to stop. So you just stop when you get to the end here. So in this one you'll get 2a, in this one you'll get 2b, and this one you'll get 1a and 1b, sorry for the order, and these will branch a little bit more, and these will stop. And then if you have a leaf here, you can return to a leaf there and to a direction there. So that's the module map. And it satisfies the action condition. It's an action. CP is acting on M. C is acting on M. And so that says that I forgot to say that C is lax in the middle. CP tensor CQ maps to CP tensor Q, and Y maps to CY. So given this diagram commutes, it says kind of if you do nothing on the C side, and then you apply your map. So if we apply phi, that's the same thing as applying phi. Oh, that's the same thing as doing nothing and then applying, yeah. These are both kind of equal. Anyway, we're trying to say this in action. So if you have CP1 tensor CP2 tensor MQ, you could first combine them and then act by phi, or you could act by phi and then act by phi again, and that has to commute. But the weird extra thing that's not just that this is an action, but that uses that C is a comonad on poly and M is a monad on poly, is that given CP tensor M of MQ, you could either comonad up to get comonad, comonad P tensor, monad, monad Q, and then kind of like consolidate, and then use the monad structure on M, or you could use the monad structure on M originally and just consolidate. So here are consolidating, if phi is called consolidating. Yeah. So it's they're kind of nice looking. I don't know if you can, they're kind of cramped in there, but It's a way, so we take the free cofree comonad and monad twice, and we can kind of like do two different things to it. We can either beef up the comonad or beef down the monad, and then kind of use this consolidation. So those are the structures that we need that makes this microservices monad exist. And the microservices monad is just, sounds maybe fancy or weird, I don't know, but I guess I forgot to define org. So org is something I've talked about previously. It's a category enriched operad. Let's just say it's a two category, or a bi-category. So the objects of this thing are just the objects of poly. They're just polynomials. But an org map from P to Q is not, there's not a set of them, there's a category of them. And the category is the PQ coalgebras. In other words, an object in this category is a machine that prints out wiring diagrams from P to Q and inputs what's flowing on those wires. We kind of said that before when we wrote down the direction, when we wrote down PQ. It's like, it's outputting maps from P to Q, which we can think of as wiring diagrams. They're more general than wiring diagrams, but they are wiring diagrams. So this thing is outputting wiring diagrams and inputting what flows on them. The position of P and the direction of Q, and that's enough to get all the data of what's flowing on those wires. So we have a coalgebra on that thing, meaning we have something that's just kind of printing out maps and inputting what's flowing on them to keep going. And it turns out that C is a functor from org to org, and it's a two comonad. And M, and that one only uses the fact that C is lacinoidal. So C is lacinoidal. I'm only going to use that to show that this is a two comonad. But for this one, I'll use that M is a C module. And not just that it's a C module in this sense, but that it has these extra ways that the comonad and monad interact. And so we can form the Kleisley category, org M, and the co-Kleisley category, org C. And org C from P to Q is just org maps from the cofree on P to Q. And org M from PQ is the org maps from P to MQ. And and so we'll define, I guess we're ready to define the microservices operad. Microservices operad is really just org M. Maybe you would call it op, I don't know. So in other words, its objects are polynomials. And a morphism in org M from P to, I'll just say Q actually, because I'm going to kind of op this later. From Q to P1 PK. So it's an operad, but it's kind of like a co-operad. I mean, a co-operad and an operad are basically the same thing. It's just that you just have this feeling like you wish you were writing the commas on the right in a co-operad. It doesn't mean anything different. So what is this? It is org maps. Now, org maps from one thing to another, we've already said what they are. There's a category of them. It's these dynamical systems that print out maps from P to Q and update based on what flows. So it's just org maps from Q to M sub P1 or So when this is the thing that when Davidov saw it, he called it the microservices operad. So why would you call it that? What it's saying is that for any problem in Q, I'm going to tell you a problem in P1 and or a problem in PK. So you can give me as many of those as you want. This big or says pick any number of them you want and give me a problem in each of those to solve. Once it solves those, maybe you just return that. Given that solution, you return it to Q and you get a solution in Q. Or if you're not done, you say, okay, thank you. Given this solution you picked, this is the next problem I want you all to solve. And then you keep going, using as many of them as you want. And then when you've hit some ending stage defined by this map, so you return your solution to Q. So this thing is the category of maps from Q to P1 through PK. It's the category of ways of taking a problem in Q and returning problems in these P's. And the morphisms in that category, the objects in that category, are ways of taking a problem in Q and returning a problem in P's for each of them to solve repeatedly. And a morphism is that you, in fact, what I didn't say is that you in fact have a whole co-algebra of that. Like, you have not only a way of taking problems in Q and giving them a problem in P, but a way of updating how you're doing that. So just like with wiring diagrams that can keep rewiring themselves, these are, you could have something that just statically takes a problem in Q and returns a bunch of problems in P to solve, but inside of this is the possibility of having something that updates the way it's doing that factorization of problems. And so that's the microservices operat, and it's that it's the Kleisley category of the free monads on Borg. The thing that I've talked about before in here is like, well, I've talked about Borg, but it's kind of useful to talk about P1, PK, Q, this operat. It's the co-Kleisley category of C, but it doesn't look exactly the same because some things, and so what it is Borg map from CP1 tensor CPK to Q. And so what this is it's a CP1 tensor. And these are for people who for Owen, if he was here, I would say these are exactly the linear effects handlers from P1 tensor PK to Q. These are like single-threaded effects handlers in Owen's sense. But roughly speaking, in terms of, like I drew this picture before, but roughly if P1 through PK are like little systems, like say P1 is A, Y to the B or something like that. And then Q is this big thing, then an object in here is a way of like wiring these things together where some of them can run faster than others. And having that way that they're wired together update based on what flows. Okay, so we're basically done. The last thing I want to say is that there's a functor from one of these operads to the other. So there's a functor from org M op to org C that lets you implement the microservices operad in this kind of older, this operad I've been working with for a little bit longer. And so it sends P to PY. In fact, for any monad P, monad T, if T is a polynomial monad like e.g. T is Y, or T is Y plus 1, the maybe monad, or T is list, or T is distributions monad, I get a functor from org M op to org C that sends P to PT. So it's for what that means is, for example, there is a functor from org Q M P1 tensor PK to, or the functor from that to org vector from that, from the HOM category over there to the HOM category over there in the opposite direction. And that means that we can implement this microservices operad using these kind of wiring diagrams things. And over in these wiring diagrams things, we think of like these P's as outputting their positions and those being aggregated to a position of the whole organization and given an input to the whole organization and the current things, the way that the information flows around between them. So it's kind of like they're pushing out their positions and pulling back in their directions. Over here, it's as though when there's map from P to Q, it's as though we're putting out problems and we're receiving solutions. So it's almost like backwards. Instead of telling someone, we have something for them, please take it and be happy, we say, here's a problem for you to solve. And that oppositeness of orientation is this oppositeness here. And it is the way that we're taking a P, like if T was Y, then PY is the positions of it are ways of taking positions in P and returning directions, so there's answers to problems. And the directions are the problems themselves. So I don't know, so it's somehow intuitively capturing the fact that these have different orientations, like the microservices operad is like giving out problems and receiving solutions, whereas the org itself, or this kind of this version of org, is like putting out positions. I don't know how to make it any clearer, but I think there's some way that intuitions, that this like fits with intuitions. So I think there's also a map from this to cat sharp in case anyone cares, like into the bimod bico module. So data migration stuff, this is too fully faithful, so locally fully faithful. So if you like data migration, then all this stuff lives in that data migration story. So I think I'll stop there.
Microservices and monad a couple of times. Was it an accident or is it a monad line?
I meant to say operand.
Okay. How does this question of sort of problem solution perspective relate to similar talk about in sort of semantics of logic, I don't know, linear logic? People have often like been saying those words in that space. Like, I don't know, is the model linear logic, for example?
I don't know. I still don't understand linear logic well enough. if it is, I'd like someone to tell me, but I don't know. So, I mean, like, dialectica was, in some sense, a model of linear logic.
Right.
Like, when you beef it up or change this or that, like, you can get it, you can kind of get it there. Dialectica is very similar to poly.
Mm-hmm.
So poly is like the free distributive category on one,
mm-hmm.
and dialectica, or what's called dependent dialectica, is a free distributive category on the arrow.
Mm-hmm.
So my guess is that since this is a kind of smaller version, like simpler,
mm-hmm.
Any sense in which that was like as it was without any kind of extra fiddling model of some fragment of linear logic, this would be too, but I can't say any more than that. Yeah.
So, what is the, I'm wondering what the role of T is and what like varying T would do in changing what's going on.
So T is this Y thing, right? So T, is a monad. Okay, what let's say if T was Y plus one, the maybe monad, then what is P T? It's, so if P is like some bundle, right? Then a map from P to Y is a section of this thing. So that's a map from P to Y. But a map from P to Y plus one is a local section. It says you don't have to finish. You could just be a local section. Map from P to Y plus one says for every position in P, either give me back a direction there or just stop, I'm good. Yeah. So this guy, the positions of this are local sections, and the directions are those inputs that succeed. Like if I have a map from P to Y plus one, then for some positions I succeed and I go on, and for other positions I kind of hit the exception. I hit the nothing of the maybe monad. And so this thing is going to say, like, I'm looking for solutions to every problem, to most of my problems, to some of my problems. So one of these is like the solutions to some of your problems. And the way you can continue on is if you hit a problem that you had a solution to. Like some of the problems don't have solutions, and then you like stop. You can never use that microservice again. It has to kind of stay there. That kind of thing. If you use T equals list, which is the sum over natural numbers of Y to the N, then every problem in P would be, we wouldn't just be getting one solution, we would be getting some number of solutions. And then the way that you continue on is you name one of your problems, one of your positions here, and you name one of the solutions you were given. And then you can keep going. I don't know if that's the kind of answer you were looking for.
No, but it's, yes.
Okay. Another nice monad is, well, I guess this will be, is dist. So dist is the, I don't know, distributions monad. It says that you pick a natural number and you pick a probability distribution on it. And then, so map from P to T, from P to dist, would say for every problem in P, give me some number. I have some number of solutions with a probability distribution on them. And then given one of those solutions, I get a solution in P. So it's kind of like a lottery on P or something. Every position in P gets some number of tickets and a distribution on how likely each ticket is. And then whenever you get a ticket back, that gives you a solution to your problem. So we kind of, what this does is it kind of just leaves it for someone else to eventually solve all the T stuff. They're gonna get in their lives some kind of big tree of distribution, probability distributions on various numbers of letters, and they're going to pick, like, they're gonna flip a coin, and then if it's heads, they're gonna roll a dice, and if it's tails, they're gonna pick a card, and blah, blah, blah. And eventually they're gonna tell you all that information, and that'll move you up your big tree.
Why don't we thank David again?